yourself together. You got stuck in a moment, and now you can't get out of it. Don't say that later will be better. Now you're stuck in a moment, and you can't get out of it.
I began driver's ed when I was 15. I had a goal of getting my license on my 16th birthday. And so I got into driver's ed just as absolutely soon as I could, and I learned very quickly that I knew nothing about driving. I learned very quickly as well that there were a lot of laws, not only to driving, but as a consequence of driving. And I remember one day hearing a law that I couldn't believe was true. In fact, I thought it was so deeply unfair. They were talking one day in class about how if you were, say, parked at a red light and a car came barreling through and ran into you, that legally it was at least 10% your fault. You see, because if you weren't there, if you were anywhere else in the world, there would have been no accident. So no matter what, if your car is hit, it's 10% your fault. If you run into a mailbox, it is 10% that mailbox's fault for existing. I was so upset about this law because I thought, well, that's not fair. Everyone else has to be paying attention. It's in everyone else's hands. And I immediately adopted a victim mentality. I imagined in this story that certainly I, 15-year-old young man armed with a driver's license, would be the one hit and not the one hitting. And so I began to learn to drive shortly after this, and I would drive with my dad. My dad was a military disciplinarian, so he and I were not the best fit of teacher and student when it came to driving. His theory with me essentially was to take me and throw me in the deep end. In fact, one day I went to school and told my friends who already had their license. My birthday is August 20th, so like, there's like a 10-day chance that anyone was younger than me in my class, right? And so everyone got their license before me in my grade. And I told them that my dad let me drive down Blue Mound Road the first day I got behind the car. And one of my friends said to me, I'm still not allowed to drive on Blue Mound, and I have my driver's license, right? So this was my dad's theory. And it had, you know, different levels of success and failure. And teens, a lot of you are in here. How many of you have your driver's license or permit yet? Any of you? Yeah. Okay, a few of you. Do you have one parent that's better to drive with than the other? You don't have to name. You don't have to say which one. But like one parent is easier for you than the other? Okay. They won't admit it, I think. So one day I'm driving my family's silver Chrysler minivan, and my mom is in the back seat, my dad is in the front seat, and I'm driving. And everything has gone absolutely swimmingly. I have hit nothing. No pedestrians have dived to get out of my way. We've had a beautiful ride through the city. Now, I lived at this point in my life in a duplex, and we had a long driveway that went along the side of the house and then entered into a wider driveway behind the house at a two-car garage. We had half of the driveway and half of the garage. And my dad did not want to back out of this strange driveway into traffic, so instead, he would have us back into our driveway. Now, this meant going backwards on a long driveway, getting to the deck of our neighbor, hanging a left backwards, and then pulling in almost like a parallel parking job into our garage. And so I'm still very, very young, a very inexperienced driver, and I start backing into our driveway, and I am having the hardest time getting the car straight while going backwards. Now, it's really not that bad what's happening, but essentially I'm just backing up like this. kind of in a squiggle line, because just because I can't get it straight. But it's not like I'm in the grass and then in the neighbor's grass and then back in the driveway. It's just a little light squiggle because I can't figure out how to get the car straight going backwards as easily as I can going forwards. And my dad, and again, I want you to know I loved my dad. My dad and I had a great relationship. But my dad decided the best way that he could help me in this scenario was to scream in my ear about what I was doing wrong. And so I've got my dad leaned over yelling at me about how to straighten out the car as I'm freaking out already because I can't get it right and I'm frustrated and angry. And so finally he's yelled enough at me that I decide I am done. I'm going to park this car. And because I was 15, I was going to make it as dramatic as possible. I was going to storm out and go inside. That would show him, like he'd never seen that before, right? So I go to slam on the brake. I'm backing up at like 2 miles an hour. So a slam on the brake is only going to be so dramatic. But in my 15-year-old mind, this makes sense. And I hit the brake as hard as I can, and I catch the very right side of the brake, and my foot slips off the brake and hits the gas. And I back up into my neighbor's living room. Fortunately, they were having a lovely family night watching television in this living room, without a couch on that wall, thankfully, when suddenly there was a 1992 minivan in their living room as part of their decor. You might imagine my already angry dad did not get compassionate at this moment. I put the car in park, I leave it in the living room, and I take off. I want to tell you this with all sincerity. My impartial mother, sitting in the back, laid the blame on my father. Now, fast forward about an hour later, calmer heads are beginning to prevail, and my father is sitting in our kitchen on the phone with the insurance company, hoping they've heard this one before. When he's on hold, I walk up to him, still seething, still quiet, still angry, and I say these words to him. Dad, I learned in driver's ed that it's at least 10% the living room's fault for being there. That didn't help, like you might imagine. It's amazing, though, how a story of my anger, like I'm going to be the victim that's going to have to pay 10% one day, turned to my advantage when I was the one who was the offender. So often we think about stories in terms of our own victim mentality and very, very rarely consider what happens when I'm the one who's causing the chaos, when I'm the problem. This is the last week of our series of Unstuck, and in the first week, I told the story of my own feeling of being stuck. In the second week, we explored together things, what happens when we're stuck and it's outside of our control. We're stuck because the world is happening around us, bad things are going on, and we're struggling. Today, I want to talk about what happens when the reason you are stuck is you. What happens when you're the reason that you are stuck? In order to do that, I want to look at a story of King David, probably his most famous story, if not his second most famous story, of a time where he just kept playing people around him like life was a game of chess, and other people were his pawns, and he as the king were using them just simply to protect himself. This story is found in 2 Samuel verses 11, or chapter 11. It's the whole chapter, but I'm just going to read the first five verses to set the scene for us, because otherwise, if I'd read verse 6, I'd had to go to like verse 27, and then we'd have been standing for a long time, and so I'll just talk our way through the rest of the story. This story is the story of David and Bathsheba. The story begins with verse 1 in 2 Samuel chapter 11. I invite you, if you would you stand with me as we read the word of the Lord today. In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David sent Joab out with the king's men and the whole Israelite army. They destroyed the Ammonites and besieged Rabbah. But David remained in Jerusalem. One evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. This woman was very beautiful. And David sent someone to find out about her. The man said, "She is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam and the wife of Uriah the Hittite." Then David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. Now she was purifying herself from her monthly uncleanness. Then she went back home. The woman conceived and sent word to David, saying, "I am pregnant." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Now, I put some color, you may have noticed, in the reading of the text today. And I did so for a very particular reason. Because in this text, David, when David is the subject, the verbs are very active. When Bathsheba is the subject, the verbs are very passive. Look at these words with David. David got up. David saw. David sent. David sent again. David slept with. These are active words. David, in this text, has agency. He has power. He can do as he pleases. He speaks and others move. His whims, his desires, his activities are central and key. When Bathsheba is spoken of in this text, she has much more passive verbs attached to her. She bathed, she was beautiful, she has a name. She is gotten. She goes home. She conceives. And she sends word to David. The only agency that she has here is bathing. And when you hear this story told sometimes in our context, like there's a movie in the 1950s with Gregory Peck and David and Bathsheba. And Bathsheba is shown as this sultry woman trying to get the attention of the king. This is like an American imagination of this story. We like to have romance in our stories, even when they're sin, right? This ancient moment in time, this is not a romantic story, and this is not a woman being illicit on top of a roof. A roof is where the bath was. She was just simply cleaning herself. And even if in this text we want to believe that she was trying to be sultry, like she wouldn't have even expected that David was home, because David is supposed to be in the same place her husband is, out at war. And so there is no king in her knowledge to seduce. She's having a bath. David is already, we are told from verse 1, the one who is in the wrong. He is not where he belongs. In fact, he has sent other people in his stead to the place of danger to fight the battle that he has called for. This is his war. And something is already happening in David that is not allowing him to own the vocation and his call in his life. He is meant to be on the battlefield with his men, strategizing the war that he has started. His being at home is already an indication that something is off with him. Something is not right with David. Now, to this point, if you know the story of David at all, you know that he begins as the shrimpy boy in the family who has God's protection and favor. David becomes a mighty warrior because God is present with him. David gets out of situations over and over and over with the very help and presence of God, time after time after time, before God finally delivers David's enemies out of the kingship, and it is given to him, and David inherits all of his predecessor's wealth and even his wives. David has everything. God has helped him acquire everything he could have possibly wanted. He sat on top of his world, and he was still in a place of struggle. And this place of struggle manifests itself in seeing a woman that is beautiful and not simply allowing her to be beautiful. He needs to have her. So he goes and has someone grab her, take her, bring her to him. He has relations with her. This is not a romance. This is an assault. She is sent back home, and David has used her for his own purposes. He wipes his hands from it, and on he goes with life. Not out to war where he belongs, but continuing to stew. He is still not satisfied. Taking another person has not made him happy. He remains in his house. Bathsheba sends word to him in a couple days, "I am pregnant," and David knows immediately that it is not her husband who is out at war where he's supposed to be who is the one who has caused this pregnancy. And so at this moment, David realizes he's in trouble because he can run for so long under the cover and guise of the power of the kingship. People will look the other way, left, right, up, and down for him because he's the king. But if Bathsheba is pregnant and her husband is off to war, someone is going to pay the consequences. So David decides that under the power of his kingship, using all that God has given him, he can begin to scheme to make it look as though Uriah is the father. And so he calls for Uriah. By the way, a little side note here, is he's known as Uriah the Hittite, which means he's not a Jew, he is a Gentile, which means that the Gentile is off fighting the Jewish king's war while the Jewish king is sleeping with his wife, right? Like, this is really bad. So the Gentile Uriah comes back. David says, "Hey, why don't you just have a night off? Go home to your wife, enjoy yourself, and then we'll send you out to the battle tomorrow." And David thinks he has sorted it. One time with his wife, everyone will just think it was Uriah's baby. And David wakes up the next morning and he finds out that Uriah has just slept at the gates of the palace instead of going home. And David is like, "What are you doing? I gave you a lottery ticket. All those men are out there fighting. I gave you the opportunity to sleep in your own bed with your own wife." And Uriah says, "I can't do that. All the men I'm fighting with don't get to do that. Why would I partake something that my men can't have?" And David has got to be just like, "You have got to be kidding me. I have found the one righteous soldier. What is going on here? This is no time for righteousness. Why don't you come to a dinner party at my house tonight?" And now David tries something else. He brings out all the best wine that he can have, figuring that if he can lubricate Uriah up just enough, he'll trip his way home that night. And whether or not he does anything, he won't remember it anyways, and we can blame it on him later. But here's the thing, Uriah is so righteous that he can get drunk and still be righteous on the other side of it. He doesn't go home. He sleeps at the front of the palace again. And David has a new problem on his hand. Even his scheming won't set him free from the sin that he has committed. And so then he begins to talk to Joab, the man he has sent out to war, the man who is in charge of his battle, the one who is now writing the plans for the war that he is supposed to do. So David decides to use his power as king to have Uriah killed. He sends coded language out to Joab that Joab receives and knows what it means. Joab will put Uriah at the front of the battle, and he'll move him up against the wall of the castle, and he'll be sure whoever's in the front will surely die. Uriah goes to the front lines. He is killed. And Joab sends more coded military language back to David, telling the messenger to comfort the king, because the king is going to be so sad to know that many of his men have died in battle, especially since the battle scheme was not the wisest. And so the man comes back and he tells David this thing. He said, David, don't be worried about it, but I want you to also know that while many men have died, one of them was Uriah the Hittite. And David gets the word he needs. And David then, again, sort of lies to the messenger back to Joab, telling him that he knows. He says to the messenger, don't let this upset you. David has just received word that he has had his own soldier killed at his own command. And he says to the messenger, don't let this bother you. The sword devours one as well as another. Press the attack against the city and destroy it. Say all of this to encourage Joab. You have got to be kidding me. That is about as slimy as it gets. The only reason they had a bad battle was because David called for it so Uriah could die. And not only did Uriah die, other men, other women in the town's husband have been killed up against the wall because Uriah needed to be put to death because David has impregnated his wife. And through all of this, David is saying, hey, don't let this discourage you. The story gets worse and worse and worse. And all along, David, God's very anointed king, the man that we are told is the man after God's own heart, makes a simple mistake over and over and over. He is operating out of the assumption that because he is the king, what he does is right. Because he is God's anointed, his choices, therefore, must be the right one. He is allowed to behave like this because he has the power to do so. How often do we make that mistake as well? We take upon us the story of Christianity. I am God's child. I am saved. I am forgiven. And then we don't critically think about the ways we behave. We assume that because we are God's child, that the ways in which we act, the way in which we talk, the way in which we process and then hand our emotions out to the world must be sanctified and holy because I'm a Christian. David assumes because of his role as king that he is allowed to do the things that kings all over the world do. Kings scheme and maneuver to cover their own tracks. They use people around them to let them have what they want. David makes a lot of assumptions here. But all of it turns out, is wrong. David can escape the watchful eye of his subjects. David can maneuver and act so the people in his kingdom don't see just how deeply sinful he is. But he cannot escape the watching eye of God. God goes to Nathan, the prophet, and sends Nathan the prophet to David. This story is found in the next chapter if you wanted to read it, but Nathan shows up at David's door. And he begins to tell him the story of an unfortunate power dynamic out in the kingdom. You see, there's this man who has a giant mega farm with sheep and crops and food everywhere. He's very, very wealthy. He has it all. And he had some people coming to visit him and wanted to cook up a nice lamb kebab for his guests, but decided he didn't want to take it from his own sheep. And so he went to a very poor man on the edge of town who didn't have anything except one little baby ewe. And the rich man took that ewe and seized it for himself, killed it, and made the lamb kebabs out of it. And David immediately bursts with anger because he sees the injustice of it. He's furious, and he says, "I will deal myself with that man. Bring him to me." And Nathan turns the text, the story, and says, "You are the man who has done this." You see, David had everything. He had anything he wanted. And he took the one wife from the man serving him in the army for himself because he wanted it. For no other reason than that. He had women, wives in his own house. He could have satisfied himself in many ways, but he took the woman of another man. He forced her into a relationship and has now impregnated her. He has had that man killed so that this woman is now taken into his house. She is now the wife of the king, and she is going to have a royal baby. And he's letting everyone celebrate the good news of a royal birth. His scheming and maneuvering, his treating people like pawns, has worked in such a way that no one has found out. And the kingdom is excited about a royal baby, but God saw. David could not escape God. He could not outmaneuver God. He could not scheme enough that God didn't see the condition of his heart. And so Nathan says there's going to be punishment for your sin. And the punishment is the baby that you've conceived with Bathsheba will die upon birth. And David is brokenhearted over this. He loves this child. And the baby is born, and it becomes ill, and David goes into prayer. Suddenly, David's power, his playing God with everyone around him, can't solve the death of his infant. His power only extends so far. He is not Lord of life and death. The baby dies. David's desperate prayers don't work. God's punishment comes. And David does the strangest thing you could possibly imagine upon the baby's birth. He goes into a time of worship of God. David has been acting in ways that aren't very becoming of a child of God up until this moment. You would think the continued narrative would be, David would be mad at God. Why would you do this to me? Shake your fist at God. But when the bad news comes, David goes and he worships. He sings. He praises the very God who has just punished him by taking the life of his baby. This is a strange moment. The story carries on to say that Bathsheba would conceive soon again, and the baby that would be born was Solomon, who would take the throne from David upon David's death. There is this strange telling of a God who won't save the baby born in sin, but yet provides the next moment of hope out of that tragedy. In this moment that in tragedy, this terrible story, David doesn't burn with anger at God, but instead turns at this moment from all of his craziness, all of his insanity, all of his sin, and says, "I've got to get myself right again with the God who has given me so much." And he goes and he worships. In fact, in his worship, there comes a psalm out of this moment. Psalm 51 is written by David on the backside of his sin with Bathsheba. And in that, we are told a whole lot about where David's heart was in this moment. I'm going to show you just a little bit from Psalm 51 here. It starts like this: "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. It carries on a little later in the chapter and says this, against you, only you have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Those must be hard words to write when it's cost you your child. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. In these words about sin, there's this going back and forth between transgression and iniquity. And I want to show you real fast that there is a Jewish concept of sin. There's essentially three ways to sin in Jewish understanding of sin. The first is transgression, and David talks about that. Transgression is knowing the commands of God. There are 613 commands of God in the Old Testament, knowing those commands and outright rebelling against those commands. I am supposed to behave this way. I didn't. I behaved this way. That is transgression. That is a sin of transgression. The next one is iniquity. This is a passion or a longing within us that causes us to sin intentionally, but not as an attempt to defy God. We may know what's right and wrong, but we're not trying to fight God here. We're humans with passions and we're not in control of them when it comes to iniquity. And then the last one is an unintentional sin. This is getting it wrong, but not intentionally and not knowingly, right? These are the three concepts of sin. And David here is very clear in his prayer in Psalm 51 that he recognizes that he is guilty of transgression and he is guilty of iniquity. And his final words that we read today are, create in me a pure heart, O God. Create in me a pure heart, O God. Because it's not just simply that he is transgressing against God. Now, as a concept of sin, I think we Christian people are pretty clear on that. There's right and wrong, there's law, there's things we're supposed to do and not do. I'm going to do the things I'm supposed to do and not do the things I'm not supposed to do. And when I do the thing I'm not supposed to do, I ask for forgiveness and I don't do it again. But this issue of iniquity is one that I want to spend just a second on as we close up today. This is not so much an issue of doing the right thing or the wrong thing. This is an issue of our heart being completely out of alignment and assuming that our status with God allows our passions and our emotions and our behavior to be justified. Just because we're doing the right thing doesn't mean we're doing it the way Jesus longs for us to do it. And so I have two conclusions for you today, and that's the first one. Just because you are a Christian does not mean that you are right. Just because you're a Christian does not mean that you're right. The Apostle Paul wrote this in a particular way that you may be familiar with, that may be helpful to you today. He said, if I have a faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. Simply bearing the name of Jesus on our life is not the same as allowing him into our emotions and our affections and the way that we act and behave as an expression of our faith. If we know right or wrong, but are filled with rage, use people and are arrogant, we are not in right alignment with Jesus. We might even say that we have iniquity in our heart. And the last thing I want you to take away with this today is this, is that sin is not just an issue of doing the right thing, but it's the state of our heart as well. You see, an issue of being right with Jesus isn't just simply doing the right thing and doing it over and over and over and not doing the wrong thing. It's about having all of ourselves in alignment with the way of Jesus. if we want to be a people who have our sin washed away and we become the holy people like Jesus for the sake of the mission and the kingdom of God in this world, that we would spend eternity with him, we have got to look at two issues here. David was still God's anointed king. He was still a Jew. He still held all of the titles and privileges of being God's chosen person. And he went way out of line in this story, because his heart wasn't right. Because he took all of those labels and stories upon himself and used it for his own privilege rather than as a servant, rather than someone who was appreciative and therefore humble. We can get in this habit, in this state as well, that we take on titles and we say, I've been a Christian for 27 years, but those around us experience rage and anger, meanness, unkindness, sadness, darkness. And a lot of times things can be happening outside of us that aren't our control, that we're not the ones who are controlling the fact that we live in a difficult time, in a difficult place, but we let the darkness of this world begin to overcome us so that we then begin to act like the darkness of the world, even though we believe we're fighting a battle in the name of Jesus. We're meant to be salt and light. And this story of David praying that God would create in him a clean heart, would remove his iniquity from him, isn't just saying, well, I have committed adultery. I have taken a woman into my house. I've killed someone. I've done these transgressions. Those things need to be forgiven. Those things need to be put in front of God and say, Lord, forgive me for my transgressions. I have done wrong. But David goes further and says, clean my heart. Make me new. Change my disposition. Don't let me match the negativity around me. Let my heart be made pure. Sin can be more all-encompassing than just right or wrong, and it allows us to miss it. Today, as we sing this final song, if you're touched at all by this, if you say, yeah, I try to do right, but goodness, I am filled with iniquity. My heart isn't right. I'm all too often angry or dark. I match the energy of this world instead of the heart of Jesus. There's forgiveness and cleansing for that as well. You may say today, no, I identify with the transgressions of David. I sin all the time. Today may be your day to stop. Today may be your day to submit yourself to Jesus and find forgiveness. And find out that you are more than the mistakes you've made, and you can be victorious over that. So the altar is going to be open as we sing. If you need a moment with Jesus to pray like David did in the psalm, create in me a clean heart, forgive my transgressions, blot out my iniquity. This is your moment, this is your time. Because the answer to that request, when you pray it to God, is always yes. That is the grace of God. You can be forgiven for your sin and cleansed of your iniquity. Would you stand with me as we sing this final song? If you need to come and spend time with God, the altar is open.